Ramadan, who sits high and looks low, and are acquainted with the difficulties and the vicissitude of life itself. We come to you today, God, humble minds and humble spirits, as an empty pitcher before a full fountain. We need you to fill us again. We need you to anoint us again. We need you to bless your people again. In the name of Jesus. And God, send your word that we may hear. And let the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer, in Jesus' name. And the people of God said, amen.
Chapter 30, the first 8 verses. First Samuel, chapter 30. Beginning at verse 1. If you have it, you can say amen.
Amen.
Most of you have it. The Bible records, and it came to pass when David and his men were come to Ziklag. Everybody say Ziklag.
Ziklag.
On the third day that the Amalekites had invaded the south, and Ziklag had smitten Ziklag and burnt it with fire, and had taken the women captives, and that were therein, they slew not any, either great or small, but carried them away and went on their way. So David and his men came to the city, and behold, it was burnt with fire, and their wives and their sons and their daughters were taken captives. Then David and the people that were with him lift up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. Mm. And David's two wives were taken captives. Ahinoam, the Jezreelitess, and Abigail, the wife of Nabal, the Carmelite. And David was greatly distressed, for the people spake of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and for his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord.
Yes.
And David said to Abiathar, the priest, Ahimelech's son, I pray thee, bring me hither the ephod. And Abiathar brought them the ephod to David. And David inquired at the Lord, saying, shall I pursue after this troop? Shall I overtake them? And he answered him, pursue, for thou shalt surely overtake them, and without fail recover all.
Yes.
Look at your neighbor with a voice of encouragement and a voice of faith and triumph.
Hallelujah.
And tell him, say, you,
you
shall recover all.
Shall recover all.
A period that's important of Israel's history. It covers a portion of about 140 years, beginning with the birth of Samuel and ending in the death of Saul. Saul started out all right, as you know, and in 1 Samuel chapter 11, verse 6, records that Saul even had God's Spirit upon him. And 1 Samuel chapter 11 verse 15 was anointed king by Samuel because he was the people's choice. But 1 Samuel also records how wicked Saul became. So in 1 Samuel 16 and 14, the believer will discover that Saul lost his anointing. And in the preceding verse, David, although a boy, was anointed to be Israel's future king. Saul became extremely jealous of David, tried to kill him 21 times, which led to David's fleeing to the Philistine territory, to Achish, the king who gave David and his 600 men the city of Ziklag to live in. The Philistines were at war with Israel, led by Saul. But they was distrustful of David's commitment. So instead of David going to the battle with them, they sent David back home. Because they thought that David may attack them from the rear while Saul would attack them from the front. Now our message today starts with what David and his men found when they returned home. The Amalekites had invaded Ziklag, burnt it with fire, and taken captive the wives and children of David and his men, also had taken their stuff and escaped to an unknown destination. No one likes to lose things, especially when somebody disrespects you by stealing your property and bogarting you and outright taking what belongs to you. Using David's plight as an example, when the enemy attacks us in like manner, the believer will discover we will recover all by using three measures that David used. First of all, when the enemy attacks you, the first thing you have to do is stay focused.
That's right.
Don't get discombobulated. Don't get fearful. Amen. Don't try to figure it out yourself, but stay focused. Understand what is happening. Hallelujah. And understand, amen, the peril that you're in.
Yes. Thank you.
The next thing you do is you pray.
Hallelujah.
You invite divine intervention.
Yes. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Yes,
you can, hallelujah, tell God, say, listen, God, this thing is too big for me.
Yes.
And I need your help
yes.
to overcome an enemy
yes.
that's stronger than I am.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
I need you, Lord.
Thank you.
Oh, folks, we say, I need you.
I need you.
Every day, yes. every hour, I need you. Oh, God, I need you.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
And then, praise the Lord. The third thing you do is when God speaks to you, and he will speak,
hallelujah.
Act upon God's word.
Yes,
God, I'm going to do just like you said, do.
Jesus.
Wow. Not going to add to it,
yes.
not going to take away from it,
thank
but
you.
Whatever you tell me to do,
uh-huh.
I'm going to do
thank
just that.
Yes. Well,
I'm going to stay focused.
Yes.
I'm going to stay proud.
Yes.
And I'm going to do just what you say
Jesus.
To do. Anybody got that determination
yes.
in their heart today?
Yes.
Hallelujah. I'm going to do just what you say
yes.
to do. St. John chapter 10 records the parable of a good shepherd. Good shepherd represents Jesus. And the sheepfold of which we are a part of. We are his sheep.
Uh-huh.
We are his people.
Mm-hmm.
And the sheep of his pasture.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Jesus tells them and identifies the devil. Mm-hmm. Calls the devil a thief.
Mm-hmm.
Say the thief coming not. He's coming.
Jesus.
But this is the reason he's coming.
Amen.
But to steal,
yes.
kill, and destroy.
Yes.
Jesus said, but I'm coming.
Yeah.
That the belief
yeah.
the sheep the of the sheepfold they shall have life
yeah.
not only life but abundant life
yeah.
you may be making funeral arrangements
Lord, Lord.
Hallelujah but I intend to live
yeah.
and not die not yet and to claim the glory of the Lord. Spiritual unseen enemy. Hallelujah. And in 6:13 and 18 of Ephesians encourages the believer to fight back.
Yes.
of the darkness of this world, spiritual weakness in high places.
Yes.
And then the Bible says, and have them all to stand, stand therefore for this reason.
Yes.
Having your head dressed up. Having your feet dressed up.
Yes.
Taking the shield of faith, taking your Bible, which is the sword of the Spirit, and fight back.
Yes.
And you know why you need to fight back? Because the Bible lets the believers know that we're going to win.
Yeah.
How do you know we're going to win?
Yeah.
God said, listen here.
Yeah.
I have given you my weaponry.
Yeah.
The whole armor of God, not yours.
Yeah.
I have given you my weaponry that has been tried and tested and never lost a battle.
Yeah.
So there you go. Paul tells the church in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 10 and 4 says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the putting down of strongholds. Even if the stronghold is in your mind. The mind has the ability to create images. Sometimes, amen, it seems like it's so real. Them dreams you're having seem like it's so real. But you need to listen to the message of the temptation in the this late 60s. He said, just your imagination. Running away with you. Hallelujah. So then we have the ability to pull down strongholds. Well, and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God and to bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Wave your hand and say, Lord, I will recover all. I'm going to take some of theirs too.
That's right.
I'm going to give the Lord a hand and say, praise Him. Praise Him. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now, let's look firstly at the psychology of trauma, of psychological trauma, that David and his men faced, and see how they overcame. 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 3 and 6 explains that because of the devastation they experienced, when they came back home, that they immediately blamed the leader. And talked among each other about stoning him, which literally meant to execute him. We're going to kill you, David.
That's right.
All our families gone, our children are gone, nobody in my pocket. Amen. Unicorns. Yeah, that's what it was. So they blame David for their problems. You know, it's easy to blame someone else rather than accepting some responsibility yourself. It's easy.
That's right.
To do that. Amen. People do that because they don't want to acknowledge guilt.
Glory to God.
And they don't want to acknowledge the fact that they may have to have a penalty because of thing that they did.
Yes.
So they blame somebody else. Now, that ain't just starting during David time. That's inherent in humanity. Mm-hmm. It's inherent because of what Adam and Eve experienced. The Lord called Adam. Where are you, Adam? He's out there hiding behind the trees.
My Lord.
Well, why are you hiding, Adam? Did you eat of the tree of the garden I told you not to eat of? Adam said, in essence, I wouldn't eat, Lord, but that woman,
that woman, look out.
She's to blame. Yes, the woman. Woman, why you did that? She said, the snake fooled me.
Mm-hmm.
And I did take the food and gave it to my husband. You see, name. But see, even though we blame others, it only compiles the guilt upon ourselves. Because in one day, you will have to pay the pipe.
Amen.
And so God tells Adam in Genesis 3 and 17,
glory,
say, listen, Adam, I love you, so I'm not going to curse you. But I'm going to curse the ground for your sake. Uh-huh. So then when you go on them jobs, can't hardly make ends meet, you go on the jobs and seem like it's overbearing. When you, praise the Lord, try to make income and ends meet, amen, don't be blaming the man. I will tell you who the man is. The man's name is Adam. Blame him. Hallelujah. Come on, clap your hand and say yes. Hallelujah. For the hard times you had.
My Lord.
Blame him for the lack of finances you had. Blame him. Praise the Lord. When family members start acting up. Blame him because he is responsible. Somebody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
So then when we're attacked, number one, what are we going to do? We're going to stay focused, right? Why should we stay focused? The Bible says in 1 Samuel 3 and 6, and David was greatly distressed when the people spake of stoning him, because all the people was grieved, every man for his son and for his daughters. But the Bible said, but David encouraged himself.
Thank
you.
You
see, some folk lose heart because they're always expecting somebody to pat them on the back.
Look out now.
Always expecting somebody tell them, well, man, you can make it. You can go in. Just looking for somebody to encourage them. But what about if you ain't got nobody?
All right.
What about if you're in a situation and nobody else around but you?
All right.
What about if you're in a situation and somebody else is in a greater situation than you? Uh-huh. Who's going to help you? Who's going to encourage you? Who's going to strengthen you? And that word encourage means to strengthen.
Hallelujah.
You got to strengthen yourself. And you got to understand that greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Yes. Look at your neighbor and give him a high five and say, you can make it.
You can make it.
Hallelujah. You can and you will,
make it.
Yes.
My Lord.
Hallelujah.
My Lord.
Yeah. Sun shining today.
Yes.
But if everything can be all right, it'll be shining tomorrow too.
Hallelujah.
You can make it.
Amen.
Trials and tribulations, heartaches, heartbreaks,
yes,
disappointments.
Yes.
You can make it. And not only can you make it, you're going to make it.
My Lord.
You're going to make it. You're going to go through. Jesus. I got 5 more minutes. Yeah, I got 5 more minutes. David encouraged himself. That word encourage or strengthen means is kazak. Used 300 times in the Old Testament. David strengthened himself, and the reason why I know he's stripping himself because he prayed.
Yes.
Stay focused and then pray. Invite God into your situation. Yes. David tells Abinadab the priest, bring me the ephod.
Well,
the ephod was a priestly garment. And when David is serving now as priest, he puts on the ephod. And in the ephod was a pocket, 2 pockets. One had the Urim, and the other had the Thummim. Urim and Thummim was 2 stones. And the theologian said, one said yes, and one said no. So David throws the stone, the Urim and the Thummim, and it turned up yes. Yes, David, go ahead. Yes, David. Pursue. Yes, David, overtake the enemy. For thou shalt without fail
about your situations? How many prayed about your dilemma? How many prayed about your crime?
Comes to arrest Jesus, 600 to arrest one man.
fisherman too, and a bad soldier. Matters got too close to Jesus, and Peter drew his sword, and he was trying to bust him upside the head. But Matthias ducked, and when he ducked, Peter just got the ear. He wasn't that skill of a swordman. Amen. It just surgically cut off the man's ear. The man ducked. And when he ducked, Peter got the ear. Jesus picked the ear up, put it back on the man, and destroyed the evidence so they couldn't arrest him. Can't arrest nobody if you ain't got no evidence. Isn't that right? And so Jesus said, Peter, don't you know that presently or right now, I can call 12 legions of angels to fight for me?
Yes.
Well, a legion, Brother King, is 6,000. 12 legions is 72,000. One angel, hallelujah, in one night, according to Isaiah, can destroy 133,000 men. Now, Cecil, let's just subtract for the sake of addition and multiplication. Let's just take two angels away. What you gonna do with two angels? Well, one of the angels gonna stand on the sea. The other angel gonna stand on the shore and declare the time shall be no more. Then the other angel gonna take the death by himself.
Well,
and put him down in the bottom of this pit and lock him up for 1,000 years. Well, I still got 10 angels. Well, 133,000 times 10 times 6,000 equals 7,980,000,000 people. So then on the face of the earth now, give or take a few, it's 7,400,000,000. Now, if there's 7 billion, hallelujah, 400 million, then that means, give or take a few, even after all this is done, every person on the earth now in the 21st century can or could have been destroyed and still have 480 million change. That's just how bad God is. Hallelujah. He don't need us. He just desired to have us to serve in his army.
Yes, yes.
Hallelujah. When God wanted to defeat giants, he sent an army of bees. Mm-hmm. When he wanted to change Pharaoh's heart, he sent an army of frogs and lice.
Right.
God don't need us, but he'd like to use us.
Hallelujah.
Anybody in the army of the Lord? Praise God. Who's here? I know some of you have lost some things. And you know why I know? Because you're here and you listen to this message. God told me to tell you, without fail, you will recover A-L-L. Hallelujah. Don't care where it's battered, don't care where it's hit, don't care how long it's been gone, you shall recover all. Not only that, you will get more.
Yeah.
You will get the increase. I don't care if the Amalekites, I don't care if the Hittites, I don't care if the Jebusites. Hallelujah. You will recover all.
My Lord.
Come on, clap your hand and give God a praise. We're standing. Amen. I just want to be what God said to be. Just want to give you a little excerpt. You know, sometimes when I listen and see preaching, I understand why a lot of us Afro-American preachers don't live long. Because we think we're professional entertainers. Mm-hmm. Amen. We're going to jump over pews. We're going to roll on the floor. We're going to shout to the top of our voice. Amen. And you know something? Out of a whole hour sermon, people are not going to be able to 6 minutes of it. They're not going to retain with 6 minutes of it. All right. And now you're going to have to kill yourself. trying to entertain them, and they're going to live with 6 minutes of your hour sermon.
That's right.
As I got old, I learned better. I learned better. I wonder why. I preach it. And I don't hurt you. And if I have a heart attack, I bet y'all didn't know it. I learned better. I want to give you a word that you can grow thereby. I want to give you a word that will feed you. Amen. Nourish you. Man should not live what? By bread only, but what?
Every
word that receives what? Out of the mouth of God. And another thing that the word does, it builds faith in you. Faith comes by what?
Hearing and hearing by the word of God.
Thank you, sir. That's what I'm doing. Building faith in you. Putting knowledge in you. Our people are destroyed because what?
Lack of knowledge.
That's my goal. That's my aim. Give a message. Not to have you pulling your hair. That'd be all right if you did. Hey, amen. You can go buy some more. You know, if you do that. They said it's a matter of school. Yeah. Hey, amen. If you just got that excited, you have to do something. Pulling hair. You know, sister, let me preach to you just for a minute. When I was coming up as a boy, and I promise you, I'll be closing out in 2 minutes. Coming up as a boy, they used to have the hats they would sell the ladies with the barbecue pins. You know, they had the pieces. You remember that? You don't remember that, it's too old for you, but they had the pieces. And some of the people who get so happy, they go to shake their head. What a piece from, I fly this way. See, Patrick Gray. And then I'm just shaking some more. Peace fly that way. They get happy. Going forward, the peace fly forward, the peace fly back. And at the end of the service, the usher comes with a handful of hair. He says, here, baby, here is your hair. You know, that's the time we were living in during that time. But now, y'all ladies so beautiful. Oh my God. Y'all pay a lot of money for that hair now. And it looks good on you too. My old pastor would say this, a woman's hair is her glory. He said, if you don't have much glory, go buy some.
That's
right. He'd say that. He was in the 90s. Go buy yourself some. So I think you ladies look good in your hair. Praise the Lord. But what I was saying is that we're not in the entertainment business. This is business in it. Salvation is very, very serious business. And we gotta learn to pray and believe God's word when He tells us to do it. And then a lot of things you won't have because you are free to ask. And then when you do ask, you don't really believe it's gonna happen. You just do it as a matter of ritual. Amen. But when you have faith in God and believe just what He says, it's going to happen. If we know that He hears us, the Bible says, whatsoever thing we ask, then we do know, not yes, not maybe, then we do know we have the petition that we asked. Ask and what? Shall. That's a promise. Shall be what? Given unto you. Good measure. Yes. Well, we got to ask. And then we got to believe. And then when we believe it, you know how we believe it? Because we act upon it. Faith without what?
Works.
Faith to act is what?
Day.
So we gotta act upon it. And if we do that, we are guaranteed. Not only to get it back, but take some of the enemy out.
My Lord.
Yeah. I think one can't chase a thousand. Two. 10,000 fighting. There's enough people in here on the devil on this territory. We're going to run him out of town. And from this intersection, we're going to run him out of town.
Amen.
And see, let me tell you something. I want to let you know this little secret. There's really not a secret. And you know why? Because we praise God too much. And anywhere the praise of God is going on, he vacates. He can't hang around. Hallelujah. He can't hang around. But we praise him too much. Hallelujah. Our eyes on your cover. Some of that's coming behind me. I say that I'm going to put off. I'm not going to have seven closing. Amen. Just grab your name, brother.